Welcome to the latest edition of the SWM podcast. No, I've not been abducted. I have not been sent to Mexico. I am your host, Billy Strachan, or as I call myself, L. Billy Strachan. I am the host of the SWM podcast. I am joined this week by the Winged Emperor, Talon Jr. Hello.
Hello, Billy. How are you doing?
I'm really warm. I'm really warm right now. For those that are listening to the podcast feed, they may not see that I am wearing a wrestling mask of my own, just so Talon Jr. here doesn't feel totally left out. But he's wearing a more appropriate mask for the occasion, and I am just boiling my head here.
It seems we've really swapped the act here.
Yeah, so, I mean, you can stick with the wrestling, though. I'll stick with doing the sitting here and speaking to you. So, right, unless you want to pick up the interview, I don't mind. I can do your answers for you if you want. It'll be a bit of a strange interview, but...
I mean, if I were to wear my mask now, I genuinely don't think viewers would be able to tell the difference. It's uncanny.
Yeah, I know. It's just... I wish I had this much hair. Right. Okay. Boring question. Let's get started then. How did you get into professional wrestling?
So I've, like many people, you'll probably find, just a fan growing up. My earliest memories of wrestling are probably from around 2008, maybe 2007. And as I grow up and sort of learn more about the world, you just sort of think, why can't I do that? So that's sort of just what we went into. So I think 2018 was when I first started training, and it's just been going from there. Started out training in Dundee, and now at FPW in Glenrothes with Andy. So yeah, it's been some ride now, and it's still hard to think that you're living the dream, you know.
Absolutely. So 2008-2009, so that was a bit of... We're coming out of maybe some lean years in WWE. Was there any favourites that stood out at that time?
Well, it comes to a favourite now, knowing what I know. But my earliest memory was something to do with the team of Jericho and the Big Show. I cannot remember what the angle was, but the longest standing memory I have was Jericho somewhere up in the crowd, holding some sort of trophy or something. I think they probably had held both belts at the time. I, for the life of me, no matter how much research I've done, I cannot find what actually happened and the first thing I'd seen to do with wrestling. Yeah, definitely, I'd just for that reason, and obviously learning about how much of a worker it was, I'd love Jericho for sure.
I guess that was bragging rights then.
Could have been. It must have been something to do with bragging rights. But me being really, I just for that age, you just look at them and you're just like, oh, the silly television man without a t-shirt. But then, obviously, then you come to learn a bit more about it. As the years went on, I'd find some new favourites. But yeah, Jericho, not only just for being like the longest memory, just for just how insanely talented he is and, well, was and is, definitely Jericho up there, one of the favourites.
Quite amazing that, I mean, 2008-2009, Jericho was really on his, what many would have said, like his kind of downturn, because he was getting older, he'd went through so many gimmick changes, and you find that one, like, was one of your favourites, which is, just shows his longevity and his creativity that's taken him, well, from, what, late 80s, early 90s onwards, where whenever he started. But yeah, that's quite incredible. You said
career half as long.
Absolutely, so especially the success he's had. He's always been, like, not always a main event guy, but he's always been round about the top wherever he's been. Especially when he came over to the WF in what 99 or something like that. Exactly. So how did you go from the fan to you said yourself that you looked at him and went, "Why can't I do it?" So how did you approach training? What made you actually go?
Well, the funny thing is that towards the back end of 2017, that's when I really clicked. That's what I was wanting to do. I was like, this is it. My mind's made up. Like, through hell or high water, I'm going to end in that training school somehow. So I did some, like, looking around and see what I could do to get through some of the doors of training schools. And then I finally decided to pull the trigger, shoot a message off, see if I could join training. To which I had no reply. So I tried again, never got in contact with anyone. So I just took it upon myself at that point, right? I'll just turn up. So my parents drove me, in fact, to the training school. I waited outside until times had gone. I didn't see anyone entering. The doors were shut. And I thought, what's going on here? I really don't know. This is it. I'm going in. They're going to have me. So I go up to the door and I try and get in. The building's entirely shut. And this carried on for about a week, nightly, maybe two, in fact, not realizing to do my research and find out that the unit had been closed for quite some time and they'd relocated. And that put me off for the rest of that year, whether it was just sort of... I thought, that's it, we'll try this again some time. Again, almost probably a year to the day I was trying to get in fact. I don't think you'd never really turn up with the right gear. It's sort of just your regular. We started there. I felt right, but obviously there was still lots to learn. I still feel like as comfortable as I am within the ring. There's nothing quite like learning to be even better.
Right, so the audio seems to be cutting out a little bit. I don't know if it's happening the same year end. So, you went to the facility several times, realised it was actually relocated, and then once you got there, you got comfortable with it, and it was just getting everything all together. Cool, right? That's fine. So that was Dundee, of course, and then. Eventually moved to FPWA with Andy Wilde and his team. Was that just more opportunities, or was it more location? What convinced you to go there?
Well, when it was sort of quite striking to see that FPWA was going to be open, and I remember just scrolling through Facebook pretty much, and it just popped up in a recommended search. Or maybe I'd seen someone like something, but it came to my attention just out of nowhere. And obviously, I was being aware of GPWA, that it was really interesting to see. So I remember signing on to the mailing list and then hearing and thinking about where this could sort of get me. I didn't feel like I wasn't going anywhere where I was before, but knowing where you could go with FPWA was really the appeal to want to go, as well as the fact that last year, all I was hearing about was how well Andy was doing at his shows. It seemed to be like really taking on the audience. And I was hearing rave reviews from the likes of even yourself on the website, checking up with the rest of the month and things. He was just up at the top. I was like, this is someone you should probably be wanting to associate yourself with and learn under. Well, he seems to be like on the run at the moment. So, those were really the main appealing factors to go, and the quality of learning and things too, it's up there.
Absolutely. I mean, when you go to a training school, the most important thing a lot of professionals say is you have to see where the trainers have been, and Andy Wilde's probably one of the most well-traveled trainers right now in wrestling, bar maybe the GPWA guys, but it's all kind of all interconnected. So definitely, hang on, I'm taking this off now. I haven't lasted long at all.
Yeah.
My head's just...
What's this about? We've gone 10 minutes. That's usually about the time when I'm feeling like I'd like to get the damn thing off as well. So.
Just sitting there boiling my head and... Oh,
top right. 10 on masking's that.
I know. The surprise. It's me. It's me, Austin. Right. Okay. I feel like I can actually process all this now. Okay. We'll speak about the mask. Because you didn't start wearing the mask, we won't reveal who you may have been before then. But what made you decide to become the Winged Emperor?
It was sort of something that I felt, if we were going to be targeting what I was doing before to a new audience, I don't. So it was towards the first few training sessions we had, Andy suggested to me, what if you were to go under mask? He didn't know prior I'd done some mask stuff, not really too serious stuff, I would say more comedy, but I enjoyed doing it. So when he suggested it to me, I thought, yeah, this is something I think I could make work again. So then it just sort of came upon to me to create the character and then draft up the masks and things. And I really think I did a pretty decent job of finding something that's going to appeal to lots of different people. There's been plenty of mask guys in Scotland and they've all done great things. Even still now, there's plenty of guys doing great stuff. So I didn't want to feel like I was treading on anyone's toes with things. I was trying to take a sort of new angle as best as I could with what I was wanting to do and present sort of my interpretation of what I would like to do with mass wrestling.
So yeah, you've got guys like, I think we've got Lucha DS, Soldato, Robbie Solar, but you're kind of moving into where he was because he's supposed to be finishing up as Solar this year. To move on is
sure.
Robert Wishart.
He had a great run.
Yeah, I think he was one of the first masked guys in Scotland that I spotted anyway. And then, of course, Lucha DS came along. I'll probably forget. Mm-hmm. I mean, you got the Sistos, but nobody wants to speak with them. But yeah, it's masked wrestling. I think that's the way you get the kids involved very easily. It's such a simple thing to do, but it's a simple thing to do. And as I've just discovered, it's not a simple thing to actually do. So how did you get acclimatized with moving from being a wrestler without a mask to actually wearing the mask?
Well, like I say, when in my time in Dundee, I'd done some mask stuff here and there. It was more just something to just get onto the show. You know, something, like you say, sort of just maybe get some of the younger fans involved because they like seeing them. So I just thought, yeah, I'll take a spot. It doesn't matter if I'm wearing a mask or not. If it's on the show, it's on the show, and it's going to be better to learn that way. So that got me really sort of used to, well, the mask I had then, just sort of looking like a dork, just getting there and in front of the crowd. So that got me sort of accustomed to it. I feel like at the time that I've spent under a mask, I'm still not really quite used to it. I think it's going to take maybe even years to get used to, because I mean, you spend maybe like what, 10 to 20 minutes wearing the mask occasionally for a show. It's not like you're, believe it or not, us guys in the mask, we don't wear them around the house. We don't wear them to go out in the street. So it's something that takes a while getting used to, but I feel like I'm starting to get there, especially with these new masks I've got behind me. These are far more comfortable. I feel like they're a bit more ring ready than what I had before. I don't know about, what about the one that you had there? Do you think you'd be able to go?
God, no. I could barely. It's really thick.
Yeah.
I mean, I got off eBay for about £5 and it's just so warm. I don't know if the hair on top adds to the heat.
Oh, for sure.
But I've got another one, which it's in a box up there. I'm not going to get it because when I wear it, I just look like a giant sperm because it's really white. It's an old it's a mystical mask.
This is exactly what I was going to say. I always wonder how, like, I've heard stories of going back to Jericho when he was in the Liger mask and he can't see, he says he can barely breathe in it too. I always wonder how, like, guys like your both Sin Caras managed to just survive in those things, especially when he had those daft lights as well. I struggle enough sometimes with mine.
I know, it's a lot. I put it on and I'm a little bit asthmatic as it is, but as soon as I put it on, it's just like, I don't know how they wrestle on them, because geez, I could barely walk downstairs on them, I think, let alone trying to do flips and stuff. So the flips, what a segue. Right, the flips. So you've got quite athletic background with your manoeuvres and stuff like that. Was that, did you do gymnastics or anything like that when you were in school and growing up?
Believe it or not, it's just one of these childhood things of owning a trampoline I think the more you spend time on it, the more you want to try new things. You wouldn't probably believe it now, but I was quite a small child. So hitting a trampoline, it was like flinging pebbles. You're just traveling, getting distance. And then as I started to grow up and get a bit older, I sort of just managed to maintain the sort of like ability to do these things. And then once you take that, put it in a wrestling ring, then it all just sort of just comes together. I'd say I'm far from perfect with form and things, but you know, the more you get comfortable with doing these things and shows, I feel like they'll probably start looking a bit more crisp in offense. But I still think for where I'm at and as little real gymnastics training that I've done, I'd say I'm quite happy with where I'm at.
So we'll go back to your wrestling for a little bit as well. One of your matches, I think must be your first match, GPWA, if I mind right, won one of our monthly polls match of the month. That was against Omar Muhammad, who was our first guest. So what was it like going into that match? Was that your first under the mask as well, under the Talon Junior mask, I should say? Was that your first match in that gear?
The character, yeah. And at the time, I was still sort of getting things ready. I didn't expect to be thrown out so soon. So it took me a while to, like that, the first run of gear I ran out, that was specifically for that show because it was something I'd had to throw together just to make the time. Obviously, I've gotten some like far better, more pro-grade stuff now. But yeah, that really sort of affected me going in thinking I don't feel as if I'm presenting the finished product quite yet. But then at the same time, I think what me and Omar managed to do in the ring probably was greater than my presentation at the time. I think really once we get back to shows being able to run, that's when I'll be able to properly show off like my finished imagination for what Talon Junior can be as a performer. But yeah, it was a great time there at GPW. I loved that match. The crowd was great.
It was really, it's kind of a very clever way. I don't know who throughout the match, whether it was Red Lightning or something, or Rudo, sorry, going, right, I want these two guys on the show, or if it was Andy going, these are the two guys I want on. But it was really clever to send out two guys that have already been in front of a crowd before, face off. Two different, totally different backgrounds though, one W3L, one Dundee, but then coming into FPWA to kind of polish off and learn more advanced things. But yeah, it's a really, really clever way to do it, to get two guys that shows off the skills of the school, but already have the experience of working the crowd.
Yeah, so. Yeah, for sure. I wouldn't have expected Omar to be my first opponent under the new guys as well. I'd known Omar like quite briefly before FPWA. Sometimes Stu would come around and sort of mesh the skills together, do some joint training sessions. So I knew of Omar. We even had a brief training match. So I sort of knew how he worked. I knew he was great. At the time, I knew he was far better than me too. So I think I've done a decent job of maybe catching up now to get onto his same sort of skill level. Just for it to go as smoothly as things did out in front of that crowd, it was really a great thing.
Awesome. Right. So I'll go through just one of the fan questions. Of course, one of your colleagues, Brent Carter, sent, just because you spoke about your parents taking you to the training school, I think it's a more appropriate time to ask, will we ever see Talon Senior?
I will definitively answer this question now. No, never. fortunately for me, but maybe unfortunately for some fans, Talon Senior will never make an appearance as a character in any of my shows. If he's involved in any way, it will be behind the wheel of a car and possibly as far back into the crowd as I can keep him.
I can just imagine now there's a faint figure in the back of one of your matches, same mask, same gear, just looking on and just keeping an eye. I was actually just imagining that you see Johnny Lyons turn up and in the full gear, because he can still go, even though he's retired, and he could be Talon Senior, but Yeah.
I'll do my best. I'll try my best to run that through him. Just maybe on a one-show basis, we'll see how it goes. I think that's how we get him back in the ring.
Exactly, yeah. On the first FPWA showcase, Talon Jr., Talon Sr. against Omar and, I don't know, Andy. Let's get Andy in there. Why not? Let's have some fun.
Why not? Sounds great.
So, goals. I mean, obviously, there's nothing going on at the moment. Is there any goals that you've got once the show's actually returned? Any place you want to go immediately, or you just want to get back in the ring?
Yeah, so definitely short term, I'm wanting to push back into Glasgow. I really think there's so many guys and girls that they're all doing so much fantastic stuff in that sort of circuit. I'm desperate to get back in there and just meet and face off as many of them as I can. It's really just that my outlook on sort of the Scottish scene as a whole is I look at it as a checklist. I want to see how many people I can meet and socialise and also find in the ring with myself. So that definitely once shows are back, I'd like to just get around as much as I possibly can on really any basis, whether that's, you know, in the ring or just being backstage. That's what I look forward to about the most. It's what I really love about like show days and everything. It's just there's such a wealth of talent and people to be around, and it's great. So definitely immediately I'd like to be back and just around the people.
Absolutely, and from that point, I mean, even if you don't, like I say, not necessarily wrestling, you can network and find opportunities, because I mean, since everything has went haywire around about June and that, there are opportunities now. Maybe some companies not coming back, but at the same time, there's companies that are starting to work together, and there's more opportunities there to wrestle. I mean, I know it will immediately happen because, of course, there'll be less of a crowd and what have you. But certainly, if there's any time for another boom in Scottish wrestling, it's really going to be once the shows come back there, to see who grabs the opportunities and does it safely as well. So as far as opponents, of course, there's haven't had as many opponents because of whatever's happening. But is there any matches that stand out from your previous experience?
Yeah, immediately that match with Omar in Glasgow, that's pretty close, if not top of the list right now. It was just a totally clean slate. A brand new crowd that we never performed in front of for me. A brand new character. And yeah, that was really special. It's something that, like, becoming more of a fan of Scottish wrestling, I thought it would almost be inachievable to get to doing like GPWA shows. Just at the time, I never thought it would be something I'd be able to do within my second year of being part of the business. So that, just for the impact that I think that match will have going forward, that definitely somewhere up the top of the list. I've had some personal ones I quite enjoyed as well. Me and some of the guys back in Dundee had a match. It was an over-18s show in the church hall in Dundee. It was me, myself, under a previous attire, teaming with UNG Mackey, I know, a favourite of yours. It was me and him teaming, which was something that, up until that point, I'd been around him, I'd never had the chance to team with him. And he seemed quite keen to take me on the team with him, which was something I was happy to have, you know, I felt like I earned it. And yeah, we had a fun match there. I'd up until that point, I'd never done any over 18 crowds, so it was definitely fun to adjust to not just the children, because at this point I was working under a mask, but not as my character now. So it was really trying to see how I could make that work to a crowd that's not necessarily I don't want to say as open to mass wrestlers, but it's not as easy to get them to be entertained as it would be to younger audiences. So that was another one I enjoyed. And obviously Mackie's there to help, and he's easy to find a way to entertain. So yeah, it was a good learning experience, that one.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about that. I never really realised that before. I think it's just because I've still got that kind of childish mindset. If I see a masked wrestler, I'm still going to be quite excited to see a masked wrestler. But yeah, I can understand that. When you're a child, you're just seeing the colours and the masks and the merchandise. You go to the desk and go, oh, I want one of the masks, like the mask guy. But yeah, if you're an older fan, it's a bit more grizzled and a bit more like...
It's something that I really, it's something I really want to try and see what I can do with this new character. I really want to push it in front of audiences who you're not necessarily going to see the masked guys around. I think that with the likes of what's going on in like Mexican and American wrestling right now, it's somewhat out in Japan as well, in fact, because a masked wrestler can just, it appeals to as many audiences as they're like able to entertain. Some of the guys that I look up to quite at the moment anyway, like Dragon Lee, I think he's fantastic, and that's a man he's managed to make this sort of aura around himself that it's, I'd say, more appealing to older fans than it would be like kids, because they know it's a hard-hitting sort of style, but you're going to get all these things that you'd see maybe like a Rey Mysterio doing, just throwing themselves around, flying all over the place. It's that sort of hybrid of style that I really want to try and get to grips with mastering. Something that not only will be entertaining towards the children, but that older audiences will be really eager to see, knowing that they're going to get a good show.
So is there anyone else? You mentioned Dragon Lee there, and like I say, you started 2008, 2009, so Rey Mysterio, of course. Was there any other masked wrestlers that you went back to watch and just see how their style was, or anyone you kind of picked character parts from, or anything like that?
Like you said, Dragon Lee and Mysterio, they're sort of the big two. I've also went back, I got quite late into... in Liger's career, Jushin Thunder Liger, I wasn't introduced to him. I know quite a lot of people were by the NXT show. I'd gotten even later than that. So just even though he just retired only this year, it feels like it was ages ago now, but yeah, it was only just this year he'd retired. It took me quite a while to go back and really get through the history books to see what sort of things he provided. Another one who I personally enjoyed the style was proper just WCW era La Parca. I love the way he carries himself. Even if it's not necessarily doing much in the ring, just how much swagger he comes into the ring with, I love it. I don't think it's something that I could personally replicate doing what I'm doing, but man, it's entertaining.
Absolutely. I mean, La Parca, I didn't watch a lot of WCW. I'm going from GIFs. But yeah, he's one of those guys who you didn't see anything, but you felt every emotion they had as well, which doesn't seem possible when you can't see the face, you can't even see the mouth, you can't see anything, but you just had to do it with his whole body to make those emotions come across, which I think is probably one of the, I would say, the hardest thing, well, bar the actual seeing. But it was probably the hardest thing as a mass wrestler to try and do.
Yeah, so I'll tell you this. Last year, I was lucky enough to travel out to Mexico. It was more of just a family holiday thing, but me being a wrestling fan, I was making sure that we were going to go to a wrestling show there. So we went to the AAA show. The guys that they have there, they've got new and younger mass wrestlers, guys who some people may be familiar with from breaking in the likes of Impact. They had... I don't know what version was, but there was a Mystico. I think the mantle changes quite a bit. Maybe I'm wrong there, but there was a Mystico. They had Laredo Kid, who I know he seemed to be on the precipice of breaking through on the American independent scene just before lockdown. I know he was doing work in Impact. I believe he'd done some AEW shows as well, and he was fantastic. And then other guys they had there, they had some of the older generations of mass wrestlers as well. Like, so your... I think the Monster Clown and Psycho Clown and all these people. I believe I got the chance to see La Parca, who'd unfortunately died quite recently, I managed to see him before, obviously, his unfortunate accident had happened. And yeah, the way that they seem so keen to entertain these older guys who you'd wonder would be a bit more conservative. They still want to perform like people remember them. They're showing off to the crowd with proper lucha style. Really, with quite a lot of disregard for, I'd probably say, their own safety, but it's what they want to do. In fact, that's the one that just sprang to my mind now, was Aerostar. Who's probably most well known for just jumping off the biggest things he can find. I was lucky enough to see him just climb up a lighting rig that was definitely pushing 20 feet in the air and just fall right out of it like it was nothing. So, yeah, it's definitely one of the craziest things I've seen live. And it was just, obviously, I wouldn't say this would go down as a learning experience, but being about this sort of wealth of Mexican masked wrestlers, that was a great learning experience. I really want to take as much as I can from that.
Excellent. So what have you been doing just now while all this is going on? Have you been just trying to train? Have you got the trampoline out again and just trying to keep yourself fresh?
I think I've gotten just far too big for the trampoline. I'd spent most of my young time on it, but now I'm pushing about 6'2", 6'3". I just genuinely don't think there's enough room for me. So we'll have to fear up and just go straight ground if we're practicing any acrobatics, I think. But yeah, just buying the time to get back. We've just gone back to training now, so we've been brushing off the ring rust. Yeah, I've done my best to keep up my shape and my cardio during lockdown, which was tough. But I think I'm in a good position now to get back to the ring and sort of just grind the axe again, get ready to go in before shows resume probably towards the end of the year in early 2021.
Yeah, I've just noticed that as of recording, of course, we'll be a couple of weeks away before this goes out. But yeah, FPWA have just opened up. Again, well, for the wee wrestlers and just, was it two, three at a time? So yeah, you found that you've kind of kept yourself well in shape during the lockdown time, and you're still
that first training session we turned up to, like cardio wise, I was really shocked at how well I seemed to be coping with the drills that Andy was giving me, but my legs hated it. It absolutely hated moving around there. So I feel like maybe once a couple of weeks have gone down, maybe once I've relaxed back into the gym as well, that I think we'll be pretty close to where we were before. As well as a lot of the drills and things just seem to be dragged through with muscle memory. Every wrestler knows their set goes. I completely forgot what I was meant to be doing, but it just seemed to be my brain and my body was just dragging me through the drills, and I just sort of sat there in bewilderment. I genuinely don't even know if I'm in the wrestling ring at this point. And there I was just doing it like there'd been no time gone.
So if you were to go right back to the start, if you were to revisit yourself when you were standing outside the right building for the training for the first time, would be any advice you'd give yourself from that point?
I'd probably tell myself not to worry as much. I definitely thought that there was, you think of sort of what wrestling's like behind the shows. If you're quite an intuitive fan, you'll know like a lot of the backstage workings and things, and maybe how people feel about new starts. But really, I wouldn't say that there was any of this sort of fear. Maybe it's just from like a generation gone past, but it always seemed like it was quite a scary thing to be starting up at a wrestling school. I always like thought it would be something along the lines of like a boot camp, but really, no, everyone's wanting to progress you. No one's out to stop you from getting better. Really, everyone wants to see you succeed. So I definitely, if I had the chance, I'd go back and tell my young self, probably just not to worry as much, to not go in with so much fear as I did of, you know, just getting in there and starting out.
So we'll go for another random question. Say random because it's the question we ask every episode. So I'm sure you've already got an answer prepared from our good friend Kevin Williams. What is your favourite dinosaur?
My favourite dinosaur is the pterodactyl.
Of course it is.
Yeah, winged emperor. Of course is going to be, you know, a flying dinosaur. No, they're cool. I think they're sweet. Maybe a close second, I'd say a triceratops. I think the triceratops are a very underrated dinosaur.
So it used to be a favourite. The first few have been triceratops, and it's the one I can kind of push on people now because, yeah. It's just a cool dinosaur. It's got horns. Sweet.
I know.
So, a bit more about yourself, like outside of the wrestling world. We do like to delve into things that I might not know anything about. We'll leave Mexican wrestling aside because I know next to nothing about that. So what's your outside of wrestling hobbies, enjoyments, passions?
I'm a huge fan of Nintendo games. I love them pieces. Usually if I'm not at training or just doing general work, I'm sitting on the Switch, I'm playing something. Another interesting fact is that when I'm not wrestling, I'm usually earning a paycheck as a barista. I make a pretty sweet coffee, so that's an open challenge to anyone in wrestling to fight me out in latte art. I don't think they stand a chance.
A latte art is something that, I don't drink coffee, so I really can't appreciate it as much. I just don't like the taste of it, just never have. I'll have a hot chocolate.
Fantastic hot chocolate.
Okay, we might be in business here. But yeah, how difficult is doing... Sorry, that sounds so sarcastic when I say that. How difficult is it? But how difficult is doing latte art?
Oh no. I think that really anyone who gets comfortable using a coffee machine, an espresso pump, you can easily get it done. It's just about getting comfortable with just how to use the milk jugs and all these sorts of things. It's something that after a while it doesn't become a job, you just find it fun, but then it does become a job again because there's customers involved. You're not just making them and then pushing them aside, you're having to deal with the person who's going to enjoy it, and you'll probably think, and you'd be right, is that coffee lovers, they love their coffee. but they love the coffee, they never seem to have much need to respect the person making it too.
Oh yeah, why would you respect someone who's available to spit in your food? Not that you ever would, but yeah, I don't understand that at all. No. If someone is dealing with something that I'm going to have to consume, I am the nicest person in the world to that particular person.
I'm happy to know that. I feel a lot of people do forget about this, but yeah, like you say, Billy, we've got a lot of power.
Exactly. I mean, I'm sure you haven't done it, but I have heard horror stories from people in that market doing ungodly things to food.
Personally, I feel like no matter how mistreated you may be, at the end of the day, the coffee and the quality of that comes above what the person deserves. So I'd like to keep my standard up, regardless of how much I'd probably like to pour it over somebody's head.
So we'll move on to less possibly gross things we can get into, but we'll go to the Nintendo. I'm a PlayStation guy, always have been. So I don't know much about what's the best things. What's the best games on Switch right now? What would you recommend?
They've just released it recently. Capcom game, I believe. It's Phoenix Wright Ace Attorney. And that sounds like the most boring possible scenario to do gaming in is law. But somehow, this trilogy of games, it's a one bundle on the Switch, it just works. I'm so invested in it. And for me, I've got absolutely zero interest in anything to do with law and crime. But, man, I'm fully enveloped in that world. It's really something. The amount of freedom you get in this game to do your best as a defendant in court, these just idiots of clients you get. Yeah, I really enjoy it. I'd like to say I know more about it, but I'm still working through the game. I'm very much a novice, but yeah, I'm really enjoying that at the moment. Other things, I've always been I've been a lifelong Pokemon fan. Hopefully that's something that a few other Scottish wrestling talent can say, because I'm willing to talk about it more than wrestling. It's a passion of mine I've had for years.
Well, I can already say that we had Brody Adler speaking about Pokemon at length. One that hasn't gone out yet this time, but there's a good 20-minute chunk with you and Mackie about Pokemon.
You struggle not to see Ewan walking around with some form of Pokemon themed merchandise on him. He has got some courage to. I have a fear of of showing out that kind of side of me, and for him, he just doesn't care. He'll go around in whatever he pleases.
Yeah, he was I think one of my final questions with them was just, what's your top... I'll ask it to you as well. But what your top five favourite Pokemon are, and that was him, 20 minutes. I just sat back and let him
easy.
He was debating with himself who to put in this top five. But
I can imagine it in his head and my voice talking about it as well.
So what were your top five Pokemon?
Oh, I'll be honest. He probably had his list set up. He probably might have had one pre-prepared, in fact, waiting to ask this question. He was probably planning to talk about it. There's very few Pokemon I like. So it would probably be easier for me to give you a top five dislike Pokemon, but I'll do my best to do the like.
Oh, yeah, we'll go with that. That's cool.
We'll go with dislike. So, three spots on this are taken off instantly by Charmander, Charmeleon, and Charizard. Just
right,
get them out.
We're just going to end the interview now.
No. While I said, oh, Wicked Emperor, I'd love the Pterodactyl, and then maybe that would carry over to dragons. No, I'm sick. This is my 20-minute rant now, Billy. I'm sick to death of having Charizard, and everything about it just crammed down my throat for as long as I've been a Pokemon fan. It is horrendous how badly pushed and marketed Charizard. If I was to put it would be sort of your 2015 to 2019 Roman Reigns or John Cena of the Pokemon world, in that you will never not hear about Charizard in a sentence about Pokemon.
I can't argue with that.
But
yeah, when the Mega Evolutions came out, you were going, oh, who's it going to be? Oh, it's Charizard. Of course it is. Charizard.
Yeah.
All right, so you've got two more spots then.
Oh,
who's worse?
I mean,
it's that ice cream one, isn't it?
Oh, no. Right, Vanillux, Vanillite, and Vanillish. I'll defend these guys to the ends of the earth. I'll admit, it's an incredibly stupid design to have an ice cream as a Pokemon. But I learned a few years ago that the designers of that intended it to be a freezer, and it's got this flake on its head that shoots out ice cubes. And then I thought, that's genius. That's better than, you know, stupid dragon with fiery tail. Like a living ice cone that in itself is a freezer that creates ice cubes. It's genius, isn't it, Billy? It's on your way to say that.
I still hate it. Okay. Right, so
it's impossible to convince people.
We still have the two slots yet left, though. The ice cream's not getting in there. Who else?
It's tough. It would probably be... Do you know what? I was originally going to say Pikachu. It's another one that everyone enjoys. But do you know what? I don't think I can actually truthfully say I dislike him. How can you hate Pikachu?
To be honest, I think a lot of people are on the fence with you with the Charizard hate. But yeah, if you put in Pikachu, I think that you would be blacklisted somewhere.
I think I was able to shout it so loudly I can actually see my follower count dropping as the podcast goes on and it's not released yet. But no, I mean, let me think. It's probably going to be something like Voltorb and Electrode. I just think they're stupid. They're just balls that roll. I don't see how, this is, like I say, this is where my 20-minute rant continues. I don't see how people look at those, that first series of games, and they go, yeah, that was the pinnacle of Pokemon design. But I really think that, like, some of them recently have not been maybe as good, but come on now. It's a ball.
I stopped at Gen 3. That's when but I've got Pokemon Go. I still play Pokemon Go.
Pokemon Go, yeah, it's fun. I really enjoy it. I've only recently dropped off just because I feel like I've hit a point where there's not much more I can do. But yeah, I think anyone who got off that when it became less popular, they should really get back into it.
Yeah, I was just every morning though, I end up going and going, what is that? Because it's all newer ones that are coming out now, and I'm well behind. After Game Boy Advance was the last, Pokemon Emerald was the last Pokemon game that I played. So
I'll definitely agree that as time's gone on, maybe the quality hasn't really gotten any better. By terms of Pokemon roster, there has been some significant improvements to earlier designs, brand new designs too. There's a lot to like. Except the ones on the Switch. I really feel like they dropped the ball with those. But we could be here for an extra hour if you get me talking about those games.
So we'll try and move away from Pokemon then, because I'm sure when I do my next podcast, Pokemon by Scottish Wrestling Network, we'll have everyone on. Which,
oh, for sure.
No, it's not the worst idea I've said out loud.
You know what? I'm pretty awful at it, but like I laid down the Laugh at Art Challenge to Scottish Wrestling, I will also throw down Pokemon battles in that challenge. I'm willing to take on anyone.
I don't know. Do you have a battle key, a thing that people add you
take,
on?
It would take me too long to find it, but you know what? I'm just gonna say, just come at me. You'll know where to find me.
So bar Nintendoing, what's your television film loves right now?
I've always loved sort of mid-noughties British TV. I could probably quote you most of the IT crowd from heart. Recently, I finished watching The Thick of It, mainly just because I love Peter Capaldi. He's got a voice, and I could probably listen to that as some form of ASMR, just him just violently tearing down the characters in The Thick of It. That would send me into a nice sleep, I believe.
I watched The Thick of It up until I think he was gone, and then I stopped watching it because it was less fun.
Yeah, they took him out for a few episodes. I think they wanted to focus on the opposition in the show. But he did thankfully come back, but it was sort of borrowed time. I think the series was ending at that point. Even I find that the opposition have some funny moments too, but no, it's the Peter Capaldi show, yeah. Really, isn't it?
To be honest, at this point, in real life, you can't parody it. It's just, it's too ridiculous. IT Crowd, though, I'm all on board with. I love that show. And I was watching one of these top 10 lists of worst US remakes, and I spotted clips of the American version. It made me sad.
Oh, man. How they managed to get Richard Ayoade to join that cast to redo it is beyond me.
It was Joel McHale, because I love him in Community, but yeah, it was so awful to watch. Especially the only clip I saw was the one where everyone came down to the basement, to the office, and it was Roy telling Moss to tell the story, the funny story.
Yeah, their holiday story.
Yeah, and Moss told it, but because it was to American around, it felt so weird because it's such a funny story. If anyone, and she'd watch IT Crowd, I'm not going to spoil it for you, but it's ridiculous. The whole thing is just amazing.
Yeah, phenomenal show.
Right, okay, so I think I've kept you long enough because I'm going to end up going to speak about Pokemon again, and
definitely. I'm itching to get something off my chest with it, but it's probably for the best. I keep this bottled up inside for probably fear of irritating my house.
Sure. Once the podcast goes out, I'm sure you'll have plenty of people challenge you to battles. And
I hope I'll be really disappointed if I'm not. Maybe it's the whole reason why I need to progress in the Scottish scene, is just to maybe just get that word out there, is that I'm really open for a Pokemon battle anytime, any place.
So you discovery wrestling just out of the crowd going, right, who's first?
Yeah, for sure.
Battle me. cool. Right, so where can people find you on the social media? Where are you?
I believe on both Twitter and Instagram, I will be at Talon Junior, maybe at Talon _ Junior. I don't know how many Talon Juniors there are out proving social networks, but those should be mine. I don't have a Facebook, so I'd prefer you find me on either of those two.
You used to have a Facebook, though, didn't you?
No, I've never started a Facebook, mainly just for the fact that I get enough unwanted contact from distant relatives that I don't think I can handle a second account with more notifications. Obviously, at some point, maybe once show's back, it will be worthwhile to create one. So look out for that, maybe. At the moment, Twitter and Instagram.
Yeah, I thought you did have it, just because I was sort of trying to tag you in something this morning on Facebook going, I'm sure you have an account. Why can't I find it? Anyway, right, before we go... Oh, Winged Emperor then. So I've just out of Pokemon stuff. I'm going to guess top five Aerodactyls in there. No, just...
Yeah, I've Aerodactyl, a new one from Gen 6, Hawlucha. I think he looks like me. At some point, I would like to get some Hawlucha-themed gear. I mean, it's in the name, Lucha. It's got to be done at some point.
I can just see you and Lucha DS. That's the team, just to Lucha you all up.
Yeah, get everyone involved. Why not?
Excellent. Right. So, sorry, total tangent. The social media one's supposed to be the last question, so we'll wrap up
there. That's fine.
But yeah, I've really enjoyed this chat. There was a little bit of audio pitching things in the start, but I think it's kind of all leveled out now, so hopefully everyone can hear it. Hope everyone got a good laugh out of that stupid mask, because...
Oh, yeah.
I think I'm going to my head.
You did it to save me putting on one. I appreciate that.
As soon as I contacted you for an interview, I thought, well, I know what I'm doing. I'm putting that mask on right at the start. But I thought it could have lasted longer, but no. But anyway, so thank you for joining us. Hopefully everyone will be checking you out on Twitter and Instagram, not in a weird way, and trying to battle you on Pokemon, no doubt. But yeah, hopefully by the time this comes out, there'll be some sort of Horizon, end of the road, and you'll be back flying about at some point.
I'd love for that to be.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Billy.